A very good morning. Today is 2nd July 2020. There are four articles of the Hindu editorial. The first article is on the Tamil Nadu custodial death, how the police reform and the crucial judicial actor. The second article is on the striking a blow against Assam's inclusive ethos, that is state language law points to be homogenized, nationalism overtaking minority linguistic and cultural aspirations. The third article is on the safety rules to be provided during the disaster of Vizag and Neyveli gas leak. The final article is on India's first COVID-19 vaccine, that is Covaxin. Even the partial effective vaccine will be in demand, but the safety aspect is a paramount. If you are first to my channel, I request you all to subscribe to my channel. I am Prashant. I welcome you all to Wi-Fi Says Study Karo. This is the cartoon of the day. The clear concept is that there are no convictions in several states, says the regarding the custodial death by the judicial system. The first article is on the Tamil Nadu custodial death. The newest episode is sensational brutality has gripped public imagination. Righteous indignation abounds on social media and the press. Underneath that gloss, a grief and agony probably crowd out every other emotions. At my vantage point, as someone working in the criminal justice system, the only emotion that the seemingly senseless act of violence inside a police station in Thoothukudi, that is in Tamil Nadu, evokes is of extreme weariness. How many more times must a powerless citizen suffer the blows of lathi or a baton, the kicks of patent leather boots, be violated by the wooden rollers around the private areas, not to mention spending hours inside a police lockup, all as a part of investigation by police searching for the truth. The judiciary as a beacon, the fatal violence by the state actor is a cruel reminder of how just a little unshackling had happened in the domain of policing to free this essential public sphere from the demons of its heritage and become an active participant in sustaining a democratic polity and not a colony. As always, when the conversation veers into the directions, it becomes natural to look towards the judiciary as a source of hope and action, and it's unsurprisingly to know that a Madhuri bench of Madras High Court has taken notice of the Thoothukudi violence on its own and is closely monitoring the situation. The Madras High Court acted in its best traditions of constitutional courts in India, which had often passed various directions to try and ameliorate the problem of the police violence. So much as that the scholars have called the Supreme Court of India as the only institution working towards the police reforms in the Indian state, the acclaim largely comes from the top court interventions of the 1990s through a case such as Joginder Kumar vs. State of UP, AIR 1994 Supreme Court 1349, and another case DK Basu vs. State of West Bengal, where the guidelines were passed to try and secure two rights in context of any state action, a right to life and a right to know. Through the guidelines, the court sought to curb the power of arrest as well as to ensure that accused person is made aware of all critical information regarding her arrest and also convey this to friends and family immediately in the event of being taken into custody. It took a decade and in the form of amendments as the Code of Criminal Procedure Amendment Act 2008 to give a statutory backing of these judicial guidelines, it remains a part of the law today. The Supreme Court went even further and perhaps too far in the case of Prakash Singh versus Union of India, where it pushed for a new legislation for governing police forces to be passed across the state in India. A key component of the new legislation was a robust setup for accountability that contemplated a grievance redress mechanism. That is, it took reportedly 11 years of the state of Tamil Nadu to actually implement Prakash Singh, a law passed in 2013 but only given in effect on 2017, and that the several states remain in contempt of the Supreme Court's judgment. I've given some insights into how seriously the issue of police reform ranks in the scheme of things for governments. Judicial concern with the police violence is also witnessed in different manner. Judicial support for significant investigation, the support and fascination for the techniques such as narco-analysis, ensuring video recording of investigations, passing orders for installing closed-circuit television cameras inside a police station, all comes from the place of grudging acceptance by the court about how often police employ physicality to obtain evidence. Through technology, then, the hope is to reduce a need of interacting with the body as a source of evidence and to gradually legitimate and dismantle a set of archaic practices reliant upon the use of force as a means of to extract the truth. There are some systematic failures. Constitutional courts have seemingly tried to change our reality of public or police brutality from well over two decades, yet we are still here with some reports, of course not to be by the state, suggesting that across that India there are many as a few custodial deaths a day. While this is undoubtedly a product of continued institution apathy towards the issue of police reform, I would like to argue that it is also clear enough evidence that a judiciary approach of simply passing directions and guidelines have proven to be a failure, and that it is an ordinary magistrate and not a constitutional court who is also a judicial actor wielding real power to realize a substantial change in police practices. This is a reason why judiciary is commonly called the weakest branch. All the noble intentions in the world cannot help transform the mere towards a court order into reality. This needs money and the power to immediate implementation, neither of which courts have. In fact, the gap between the highest court and lowly police officer in India has been demonstrated through studies which shows how, despite criminal laws being struck down as unconstitutional, they continue to be enforced in various parts of the country by local police. Rather, they expend energies into only passing more guidelines. Constitutional courts must seriously contend with the concrete cases that come their way and expose how hard it is for a common man to get justice against a police violence, either through compensation claims or prosecutions. There's a culture of impunity. At the same time, the constitutional courts must shed the institutional baggage which often leads to them protecting and supporting vulnerable morally of police. This tendency was on display when the Madras High Court reportedly saw Thoothukudi incident as a result of few bad apples running the system's reputation. That, with the due respect, is to enable the sea of the wood for the trees. It is a culture of impunity that the apples experience which leads to a few to wield the baton with such fatal vigor. Rather than minimize, perhaps it is a time to consider sanctions at the larger scale and impose monetary penalties at the district level to drive home the message that the erring actions of one officer must be seen as a failure of the force itself. Finally, the Constitutional Court could strike as an inspired move by reorienting their guidelines to try and change the practices of magistrates over whom they exercise power and superintendence, as opposed to another non-judicial actors. For it, the local magistrate before whom all arrested or detained persons must be produced within the 24 hours of time, and thus becomes a point of first contact for the citizen with a constitutional rule of law that Indians take so much pride in. The Thoothukudi incident had brought to fore what appears to have been inexcusable lapses by the magistrate. It is a tragedy that the laxity apparently on the display there in remanding accused persons to further custody, both police and judicial, is not the expectation but a norm in my experience. The overworked magistrate struggling with an ever-exploding docket is very often in a rush to get done with the remand case rather than treat an arrested person with the care and consideration that she deserves and is entitled to. This is not a fault of magistrate but a crystallization of systematic failure of which constitutionally courts are indirectly responsible for and could do so much to change. This is regarding the police reforms and a crucial judicial actor. This article was penned by a practicing lawyer of Tamil Nadu. The next article is on Assam's inclusive ethos, that is, the Assam government recently decided to promulgate the law to make Assam's language compulsory in all schools, both public and private, including Kendriya Vidyalayas from class 1 to class 10. The state governor has already given a formal assent to the cabinet decision. However, the law will not be applicable in Barak Valley, Boland Council and other 6 scheduled areas where Bengali, Bodo are other indigenous languages which will take precedence. The Assamese nationalists are of course happy. Some are even demanding for it to be made compulsory and in the exempted areas. However, none of them is taking about what effects it will have a community such as Missings, Deros and Rahabs and other small tribes in their mother tongues. The data and politics. The statistical data have also been used as a tool to construct the linguistic hierarchy and hegemonization or homogenization into the region. This is to turn become an elemental crucial for constructing and stabilizing the regional political economic hegemonies. We have also seen that it happened in North India with the consensus driven communal split in Hindu-Urdu, presuming Muslims to be Urdu speakers while Hindus to be Hindi speakers. Crucially, this politics marginalized languages such as Magadhi, Awadhi, Bhojpuri, Garhwali, which is the rich literary and linguistic traditions as the mute dialects of Hindi language. And this was also a political number game to ensure the dominance of Hindi and Hindi elites nationally. A similar approach is also evident in Assam. Census data are often used to portray a danger of Assamese language. The infiltration of Bengali-speaking communities is considered to be the primary reason. The number of Assamese speakers as per 2011 census comes as 48% of the population. In 1971, the percentage of the speakers were about 60%. So it seems that number of Assamese speakers considerably declined in these 4 decades, but this data need to be looked at empirically. It has also to be noted that the most tribal community speaks Assamese but return to their own respective language as their mother tongues. For example, the Missing tribe, which I belong to, a large majority speak Assamese. This is not because of school education, but mainly because of the fact that Assamese is a dominant marketing language. The impact of tribal language. The impositions of Assamese had also an adverse effects on tribal language, especially on those who do not enjoy any constitutional protection. Tribal languages are generally a steady decline. For instance, while the Missing tribe reportedly a rate of increase, that is 41% in the number of speakers in 2001 census, by 2011 it is merely 14%. Similarly, the Dieris, which is reportedly a dissidential increase of 56% in 2001 census, an increased percentage by 2011, had been declined to 15%. It is now noted that only some of the languages now speak as a language. The Rahabas community provide a more curious case. The community reported on the increase of 18% of the number of speakers in 2001 census. By 2011, the number of speakers have decreased 15%. The tribal communities since long have been demanding the linguistic and territorial protection and attention of the state government. On October 30, 1985, the government of Assam, in response to long struggle by Missing community through a gazette notification, introduced by Missing language as an additional subject of classes 3 and 4 of Missing dominated areas. Also, additionally, it is also the medium of instruction at a primary level. The Assam government was supposed to take various actions such as appointing a Missing language teachers, translating books into Missing and also introducing Missing textbook. But only 230 teachers were appointed till 1994. Tribal communities have also resisted attempts to force homogenization. It was the response to the official language bill in 1960 that the Khasi, along with the tribal communities, started protesting, ultimately leading to the formation of Meghalaya. The Bodo movement for autonomy also finds its roots in this bill. Tribes have also often highlighted that the Assamese nationalism discourse was narrow and rarely included other communities. However, tribes such as missings, Dheros, Rahabas, etc., have still consistently supported the Assamese movement against the imposition of Bengali language or Hindi in Assam. The Citizenship Amendment Act is also a factor, could have been a point of departure of Assamese nationalism discourse. During the course of the movement, a new definition of Assamese indigenous was seen emerging. The definition was inclusive of tribal and non-tribal non-Assami communities of the which was based on the domicile rather than language alone. However, at the core of the movement was to fear of infiltration that CAA bill promoted. Since the fear and insecurity have immense tendency to straitjacket heterogeneous aspirations and scuttle the inclusive nature of the movement, the government is a fact of manipulating this element of the fear by rising linguistical nationalism to weaken the inclusive and anti-hegemonic build-up in the anti-CAA movement in Assam. As a job requirement, adding to this, the Home Minister of Assam stated that the government is also mulling over the separate legislation which will make only those who learn Assamese till their matriculation suitable for government jobs in Assam. These moves are not clear or clear indications and non-inclusive homogenized Assamese nationalism taking precedence over the inculcation of minority linguistic and cultural aspirations. Such a move alienates various linguistic identities such as those of the tribes in Dheros, Rahabas and Missing, etc., and limit the definition of exomia to the just speaker by the language. By bringing in such a law, the state government is seeking to overcome the legislation crisis that its support to CAA has created. While the tribes acknowledge that the threat that infiltration poses to local language and culture, they are also wary of Assamese hegemony and homogeneity. This law will also increase the marginalization of these communities, triggering social conflicts once again. It's time for progressive section in Assam to go beyond the politics of fear and assert the inclusive of ethos of Assam. This is regarding a striking a blow against Assamese inclusion, how Assam government is planning to implement Assam language compulsory in all schools and even in job sectors. The next article is on safety norms by to be taken for the disasters. Two deadly industrial disasters in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh leading to the loss of at least 8 lives and causing serious injuries to many once again underscored the value of safety protocols. In boiler blast that is a Neyveli thermal plant, 6 people were killed and a dozen workers suffered severe burns, while a toxic chemical leak at a pharmaceutical plant in Vizag led to 2 deaths immediately. These two other recent disasters at Neyveli power plant and LG polymers factory at Visakhapatnam area have come at a stressful time when India is also trying to find its feet in the midst of a pandemic. What happened in Neyveli on Wednesday is inexplicable since the power producer has encountered a boiler furnace blowout on May 7th and had ordered a review of infrastructure and process. Without meticulous care, boilers are dangerous pieces of equipment. High pressure and superheated steam make for a lethal combination. If their release mechanism is not kept in a good order and there is an explosion, for this reason they are regularly strictly under the Indian Boilers Act, at least on a paper. The terrible consequences of lax boiler safety were evident 3 years ago, and Ray Barrel, which is a blast of NTPC power plant, killed a few dozen people. But state have to clearly not internalized a culture of zero tolerance to boiler accidents. The gas leak in Visakhapatnam, apparently involving benzimidazole, a chemical used in pharmaceuticals, raised questions on maintenance and operational procedures. The probe in how vapors of stable but acutely toxic chemical escape should lead to upgrade a safety protocol. In Neyveli incident, there is a suggestion that the boiler was not in operation as it had tripped and was the process of being revived. Since major operations of the equipment involved the furnace and production of steam, what led to the unexpected blowout? NLC India, as a key profile producer, has an obligation to prevent or present the transparent reports on which why it facilitates a behest by the mishaps. Occupational safety demands that the boiler are operated by trained personnel, but some of those on the ground have been described as a contract employees. It also takes an independent probe to determine whether the cost calculations guided staffing decision is such a hazardous sector. The response of state and center's industrial accidents is usually to stem public outrage by announcing compensation for victims. A transparent inquiry and leads to fixing the responsibilities and reform is such a low priority. The culture must change. So incidents or accidents are also most preventable and occur rarely in the industrialized world because of impeccable attention to the safety. India's aspirations to industrialize should be founded on the safety. The next article is on COVID-19 Covaxin, which was developed by India's first indigenous COVID-19 vaccine, which was developed by Hyderabad-based company in collaboration with ICMR, is all set to be tested on humans. Even partially effective vaccines will be in demand, but the safety aspect is paramount. The permissions from the Drugs Controller General of India to carry out phase 1 and phase 2 human clinical trials were based on the safety and efficacy results of studies on mice, rats and rabbits. The phase 1 trials on the candidates vaccine used inactivated, that is novel coronavirus, will begin in the month to testify its safety. The virus used for developing the vaccine will also isolated by Pune-based National Institute of Virology for samples collected in India. Meanwhile, a Pune-based company is all set to manufacture 2 to 3 million doses of the University of Oxford vaccine if the results of the phase 1 clinical trial, which are expected to be in the first week of July, are encouraging. Millions of doses more than will be manufactured if the results of the combined phase 1 or 2 3 trial are reassuring. In addition, the two companies are collaborating with the universities and biotechnical company to develop 3 or more vaccines. With this pandemic raging with no antivirals available to treat severe COVID-19 patients, a vaccine that is even partially effective and protects for about a year will be in demand. This is indigenous vaccine will mean guaranteed availability for Indians, while a significant percentage of Oxford vaccine manufactured in India will be embarked by the local consumption. This is regarding the effective partial effective vaccines in demand, but the safety aspect should be paramount on promise on delivery of India's first COVID-19. Thanks for joining me. If you are first to my channel, I request you all to subscribe. That's the end of article discussion.